Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for allowing us to be here just one more day, Lord Jesus, Lord. Lord, we're looking for a word, an evangelistical word on tonight, Lord Jesus. One, Lord Jesus, that reach out to the souls, Lord. Those who need to be called into the flock, Lord Jesus. There's one fold. There is one shepherd, Lord Jesus, Lord. Give us, teach us your way on tonight, Lord Jesus, Lord. That we may learn how to serve, Lord Jesus, by, Lord, ministering to others, Lord. By praying for others, Lord. By being on one accord in the house, Lord Jesus. Lord, you are worthy, you are powerful, Lord. Lord, use me on tonight, Lord, to give you glory, honor, and praise. Not my way, but thy will, let it all say. Not my way, Lord Jesus, but your way, Lord Jesus, Lord. This we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. I want to give honor to our apostle and our presiding Bishop McLeod and the bishops, Bishop Sean and Bishop Brookshire on tonight, and the angel of this house, my teacher, Bishop Shaw, and First Lady Shaw and the Shaw family, and our official elder, Braxton, and Sister Braxton on tonight. Hallelujah. We thank God for elevation. Amen. Amen. And my favorite mother, Mother Shaw, was good to see you on tonight, and everybody else in the house tonight. I thank the Lord tonight for all that he's done. And I've been praying and asking the Lord, you know, what is it that you want me to talk about? And it's amazing that she would sing that the Lord would have us on one accord, and she would sing the song, I Love You, Lord. Because the question on tonight was, do we love the Lord on tonight? And how much do we love the Lord? I will not be before you all long on tonight. I've been going through a lot of changes on these past couple of weeks. I got some people to call in and say, hey, they're going to get baptized. And I got some other people calling in talking about baptism. And you know, some of my friends who I have prayed for, who, you know, at one point in time, you know, were the world like I was. And so, it was a blessing. And I asked the Lord, you know, what is it, you know, and he said that, you know, you got to love the Lord in order to minister to his people. And I asked, well, what do you mean by love? To love you, Lord? He said, you know, there are a lot of people out here who talk a good talk, but don't walk.
That's right.
Walk. It's easy to talk about something. And, you know, I begin to think about the name of Jesus. And what does it mean to me? What have we given up? See, when you're going to evangelize, it's almost like if you've been a salesperson like myself and Elder Braxton, you know, your product has to mean something to you.
Yeah.
And it has to be the best thing at that time in your life.
Right.
And if it's not, it's going to be really hard for you to convince somebody who's purchasing the product to buy the product.
That's right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Jesus has to be that product every day in our lives. And not just any Jesus. See, you can't sell a Trinity Jesus.
Come on.
Okay, you can't sell a Catholic Jesus or a Protestant Jesus. There's only one God. And if you love the Lord, you will begin to understand your products. And when you love to sell, you have to understand the interior of your car, the engine. You have to understand how fast the car can go for those people who like to drive fast. And for those who love security, you have to understand the angles, you know, for security, the airbags, and, you know, and everything. And for those who want to keep expenses down, you know, you want to make sure that they get a low cut on their insurance rates and things like that. So you have to understand all the aspects. See, when we go into the Word of God, we have to understand the angles of the Word of God. The miscues, somebody might come into, if you're a car salesman, and they may come in and try to manipulate you. But you have to be knowledgeable enough to understand where they're coming from. It is no different than evangelism.
Right.
See, when we going out there are some who soon to be high-minded, may think they know more than me, may think they have a better understanding. But see, if I understand my product, if I love Jesus enough, okay, I will stand on that rock. And when I'm standing on that rock, I'm not going to allow you to pull me off my rock. Amen? Amen. This comes from the love. The first commandment that the Lord gave was to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, thy mind, and thy soul. As we go through the scriptures today, I just wanted to talk about Jesus. Is that okay?
That's all right.
If we go to evangelize, we got to evangelize the truth.
All right.
I've been going through this weekend, and the scriptures were brought to me. We're going to start at Matthew 28. We're going to keep it real basic. We keep it there. Matthew 28, 19, we all know what it says. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Now, for some people, that sounds a little confusing. Okay, if you ever watch a TV ad, sometimes they'll tell you this great big cell, they'll have this great big advertisement with a little small print on the bottom. You know, what happens is that we're so mesmerized by what we read that we don't take time to comprehend what the word is saying.
Yeah.
You know, that's how they get you in commercials. They get you to call in because it sounds great. You know, you think you're getting a great deal and they trick you on some things.
Yeah.
You know, but that's because it wasn't the commercial's fault, because they abide by the rules.
Uh-huh.
You fail to read.
Uh-huh.
See, this is how we get something. We don't get something because of success. We fall short because of our failures. Okay? So when we go and we look at the scripture, and the Bible says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Well, it sounds like real, but that's because I read it wrong. See, anytime I'm teaching Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, okay, it's a lot of times it's just the simple fact that I wasn't paying attention to the details. I didn't study my product. Because when I went to Acts chapter 2 and 38, the disciples who were standing there at Matthew 10, 19 and 28,
right,
began to baptize in the name of Jesus. So how did I get out of one verse of Trinitarian doctrine and fail to read the rest of the instructional manual?
Right.
Okay, this is like when you have a new phone in your hand and you don't read the instructions, you begin to just press all the buttons. You really don't know what you're doing. Okay, then your phone break and you want to blame it on the phone and say the phone's up. Okay, it don't work. When in reality, you didn't read all the instructions.
Yeah.
You didn't take everything in. See, that's why somebody sold you that product and you didn't sell it to them.
Right.
Okay, because they understood the material.
Yeah.
Okay, this is what happens when people, when we get out here and we reach these people, there's something broken, there's something they're lacking, there's something that they're missing. They didn't read the whole manual. They didn't understand everything. Okay, and so when we begin to teach this word, you know, I tell people a lot of times, you read Matthew 19, but did you just go up one more verse?
Yeah.
If you started at Matthew 8, it says, and Jesus came and spake to them, saying, all power was given unto me in heaven and in earth.
That's right.
Well, if Jesus got all the power, who is God? If he has all the power, who is God? See, when we evangelize, I'm talking to y'all young people. See, this is going to be for y'all one day. You guys go to college, go to high school, you're going to run into a lot of people who, you know, who aren't living according to how we're living, and you will take a class called Religion 2300 at HCC. I encourage all of y'all to take it. You think you know as much as you think you know? Go take that class. Okay? It will make you study. Okay? When you sitting here thinking that you know everything, there's a lot of times we sit up in this church and we're missing the bus. We sit at the bus stop, but we ain't getting on the bus. Okay? We don't want to pay the cost of studying and show ourselves approved unto God, so we sit on the bus stop. And the bus comes every day, Monday through Sunday. Okay? And yet we still miss the bus. See, this is the lack that I'm referencing here. This is how I know you don't know your product. If I can fool you into believing, if I can fool you into believing that I know, then I've done it. I fought for 2 years that woman could not be a, that woman could be a pastor, and I had young brothers coming to me, asking me questions, and I defended myself, and I defended myself quite well, right? Yet these brothers were teaching the truth. They were telling me the truth.
Yeah.
Telling the truth. Yeah. I got them so mixed up, man, they started asking me for documents and emails. They began to ask me questions. Okay, you didn't love your product enough. You didn't love the Lord enough. Because if you loved him just enough, you would have got through to me at that point in time. Okay? And I've got you now asking me. I'm supposed to be asking you. You can't sell me, humanity. I'm sorry. You can't outsell me. I am the licensed agent here. Okay? You gonna tell me, you can't tell me about my product. I know everything about my product. Okay? Everything. I'm gonna tell you about the product before you tell me. Matter of fact, you will start a question, I'll finish it with the answer before you get done. Okay? That's how we have to be when it comes to evangelism. That's how we have to be. We get confused, we can't defend ourselves with scriptures. A lot of times we can go around and say, well, I know that the Bible. Bible says we are about to baptize in the name of Jesus.
And we can't defend.
We can't simply defend. No. All right, the word, what we standing on. Yeah. Well, if you can't defend it, how are you standing on it? See, this is how much we have to love the Lord.
Yes, sir.
This is how much we have to love. We get to a point sometimes that we want to have a respect of persons. Well, we want to say, some of us, you know, we don't want to stand on righteousness too much.
Yes.
You know, because then I'm going to offend somebody. Or if I'm at a church, I had one somebody come to me and said, yeah, I go to this church and, you know, they believe in second marriages and all that. And I said, but I just go over there and fellowship with them. I just go over there, you know, I hang out with them. I said, but then what point in time are you standing for righteousness? When are you going to stand up and say, you know, I know that's wrong?
That's right.
Okay. Because, see, the problem with the person who just comes to work every day, don't really care about the product. Or the problem with this type of person is that, you know, when you really need something, when the customer on the other end of that line or that car, that person really needs the car, you're not the person that can help them. If you don't know the word of God, you're not the person that can save them. Okay? You don't let somebody in the field. Now, if you've been in the military, you know the rule, we don't leave a soldier on the field by any means necessary. If you gotta die with him, you die with him, but you don't leave nobody on the field. When you don't study your word, when you begin to please people, you leave souls on the field. You leave them on the field. You leave souls there for them on the field. Not because of their life, it was your job.
Yes.
You were the salesperson. Okay? This is why we study. Amen. But we got people pleasers. We got those who don't want to be confrontational. Paul was very confrontational. Okay? Matter of fact, Jesus was confrontational. Okay? John the Baptist was confrontational. Okay? These men stood for the truth. Okay, so when we go in places and people say, I ain't trying to hear you, I'm trying to hear you, but listen, you talking all that, and you say, well, I'm going to back away, you know, and you don't stand. Now, I'm not saying you get to a fight, but what I am saying is that you stand for that righteousness. Once you back down and say, well, I'm going to think about it, it's not a thinking situation. It's not optional.
That's right.
Okay, there's only one way into heaven. Either you're going or you ain't. Okay, it's only one way. It's only one way. But the Bible says something very important. I was talking to a friend of mine today in Galatians chapter 1, verse 10. These are the people pleasers. If you are people pleasers, you can't evangelize.
That's right.
Galatians chapter 1, verse 10. Okay? If you are going to handle out here and run away from the souls that need to be saved, okay, we're going to probably need you to follow them. Stand here a little long. Study to show thyself approved. Galatians 1 and 10 says, for do I not persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. We're going to read that one more time. For do I persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? There's a question here. Who you pleasing? Who you pleasing? See, when you start teaching the false doctrine, you get all the people in your audience, and you know, you got that money coming in, who you pleasing? Who you pleasing? Can't please God. Come on now. Everybody say, oh, they're baptizing them in the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, baptizing this. You can't be pleasing God because ain't no souls getting saved. Ain't no souls getting saved. Okay? So, question is, if I please men, I should not be a servant of Christ. As an evangelist, people are not going to be happy with you. If you ain't suffering persecution, you ain't saving nobody.
That's right.
Okay? All right? This thing is a work. Okay? It is a work. All ministry is a work. It is not a Friday night event. It is an everyday event. Okay? Every day. Matter of fact, if you knock here on Friday, it's not hard for me to understand you evangelizing, period.
Come on.
Because this is the night that everybody goes out and does everything wrong, yet you are out there with them. Okay, so which side do you stand on? Who are you pleasing? Who are you pleasing?
My Lord.
Do you love God? Do you? I mean, it's really hard to tell when we're singing and giving God praise on Sunday and Sunday night, you know, and then we can sit down, come in late on Tuesday and leave early on Tuesday night. Who are you pleasing? Now, when it says men, please understand, I'm not just talking about your friend and family. I'm talking about yourself. yourself.
That's right.
Okay, because you got any man, sometimes we get tired. Sometimes we get hungry. Sometimes we get lazy. Okay? Right? And we begin to serve ourselves.
That's right.
Sometimes you can please yourself more than you can please God. And the moment you begin to please yourself, you cannot be a servant of God. Again, if you can't be a servant of God, how can you minister? How can we minister? As I was going through and I was, you know, dealing with talking about the love of Jesus, when they, on 1 Timothy, and we'll put that on, and I'm gonna let y'all go, because this was a icebreaker for me. 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 12, as I was talking earlier about the love of God, and I fought many people about the woman pastor. I began to study the hermeneutics, the dogmatic theories. I had studied it a lot, and I just want to show you, if you love God,
come on.
If you love him, okay, you will stand for righteousness.
Right.
So I'm going to give you a quick background on this scripture, why this scripture means so much to me. I was sitting at work one day, and a friend of mine who was Baptist came to me and said, hey, man, he said, you know, you ought to be studying your words. Yeah, man, you know. He said, I got a question for you. He said, I heard you got a woman pastor. I said, yeah, okay. He said, can a woman be a pastor? I said, yeah, why can't you be a pastor? Then he brought me to the scripture and said, but I serve not a woman to teach, nor to serve authority over the man, but to be in silence. Well, I read the scripture, and I'll be honest with you. Man, I was baffled. He got me good. I had really no answer. Matter of fact, I made some up. I think I said something like, when I was with Paul said something, I began to talk about, I was using the same excuse that everybody else used about the name Jesus. Well, that's your interpretation. You know, I had no defense at that time. Please understand, I went home and I studied.
Amen.
I stayed up to 3 or 4 o'clock at night. I began to read other dogmatic theories. But what I was searching for was a self pride mentality answer. In other words, I wasn't looking for the truth. I was looking to be right.
There you go.
That was the problem. And so I began to study the word, and I began to study, and I even used Judges chapter 4, where Deborah was a judge, therefore she can judge Israel, and then a woman can be a pastor. I used them all. Matter of fact, I found a theory that said Phoebe was a minister, and a minister meant diakonos in the Greek, and therefore she was a minister like Paul. So if she was like Paul, that means she could be a preacher. I mean, she could be a pastor. Man, I had it all. Man, I had it all laid out. Documents upon documents. I had pages, internet pages. I had it all laid out. And I'm telling you, I proved it to them. I'm telling you, I proved it to everybody but me. My head cried on that thing every night. Because although I felt I was right, I knew I was wrong. I knew I was wrong. See, this is where, am I going to please man? Or am I going to please God? I began to study some more, study some more, study some more. And the more I studied, the more I found that maybe I might be in the wrong place.
Oh,
I just might be in the wrong place. And finally, after 2 years, one night I woke up and I had the world's biggest headache. I was fed up. I was fed up.
Yes, sir.
Because I was not going to lose Jesus. I can lose everything else, but I wasn't going to give up Jesus. I said, Lord, whatever your word says, that's what I'm going to do. I had finally made up. The Father broke that pride. Okay, this is why we study. This is why we continue to go through what we go through. Okay, and so, not even, matter of fact, that same week, I talked to Bishop, and he told me, before he came, before I got to talk to him, he was excited, man. I was so shocked. Bishop was so happy to talk. I don't know, man, what's going on? And I said, okay, well, you know, I'm at work right now, so I called him when I get off of work. So I was excited, had all my notes, you know, had them all saved up on my little documents, little shortcut sheet, everything, I was ready. I began to walk down the stairs, and I heard the Lord say, when he speaks, you be quiet. And when he said it, You know, sometimes, you know, we talk about the whisper, you know, that he's a whisper. This wasn't a whisper, y'all. It's loud and clear. It was loud and clear. I walked down the stairs. I called Bishop. Bishop broke down every reason in the Bible. Every reason why the wild woman could not be a pastor. He went to scriptures I had no idea was in the Word of God. Yet I've studied and I've read the Word of God. Okay? But I had a choice to make. Was I still going to be a man, please? Now, mind you, I was over the youth. I had the youth on Friday night. I was over the praise team. I was over the choir. I was a minister of music. I worked with the Florida State musicians. Okay? I was a good time. Everybody knew me. But was I going to please man? Or was I going to please the Lord? Because of what I had studied, and because I didn't want to lose the Lord, I told Bishop, I asked Bishop to do me a favor. I said, Bishop, I said, if you could just do me one favor, pray for me. And the reason I asked pray for me, because I knew what had to be done. How much do you love Jesus? How much do you love? Not more than 10 days later, I got called into a meeting. I got yelled at. I got almost cursed out. Okay? And as they were yelling, I was calm. And I said, all I did was, if you guys don't know, I sent an email to the woman pastor and asked her, are we a church out of order? I wrote about a 4 or 5 page document of everything that Bishop had given me. Okay. And I showed her, and she told me she wasn't going to go around this mountain with me. Told me that. I said, well, I'm going to need you to take me around this mountain because we are order. We are order. Okay. What was up for stake, you have to understand, was my niece and nephews being at the church. You know, my praise team, not my praise team, but, you know, the praise team of the church. You know, all the elders and everybody knew me in the brotherhood. And, you know, this is our thing. I walked in places, man. They love me being there. Oh, brother, hey, over there, you know, come on, let's keep on, bro. Man, we need you up here, man. Hey, we need you up at the choir. The state for the state choir together. You know, and come on, man, we need you playing Orlando and New Smyrna and all them other places out there, you know. You know, so listen, man, I'm telling you, man, it was good. I had a blast with the kids. It was my heart. But see, somebody has to stand for righteousness. Somebody, okay, got to live this thing right. Somebody, when the word is brought forth, we have to make a decision. If you are not willing to stand at all costs, when I say at all costs, I lost everybody. People were told not to talk to me. I was told if I go back on the premises, that they would call the cops and I would go to jail for trespassing. That's what was told to me. As a matter of fact, on Wednesday night when they had choir rehearsal, I was so used to being in church. I had asked Jonas if it was okay if I just sit in the church. Because I had nowhere to go. And I had one other prayer. I said, Lord, don't leave me in the wilderness. I stood by your word. I did what you told me to do. My mind was already made up. I had to serve the Lord. And even if I had to go all the way back to San Francisco, Ohio, go to church, fine, so be it. But I understand that a woman could not be a pastor. That came from studying. That came from doing the work. This ministry of evangelism is a work. You got to give up something in order to gain something. And everything you give up is worth a soul being saved. Now, I told you the ending part of it. Well, I told you the ending of that. Well, see, I got a new beginning. I was told when I first came to the church that people had told me that, you know, we prayed for you, man. We prayed for a position, and we prayed for you. And I began to think, how did y'all pray for me? Y'all don't even know me. You didn't know me for nobody. I sat in the back of my room. Well, to Jonas said that to me, probably a little bit of this. But no, 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 no. So how can you pray for someone? The Lord reminded me, I'm gonna let you go. This is why we evangelize, y'all. This is why we evangelize. I'm gonna tell you this is why I evangelize. The Lord reminded me, he said, I wanna let you know that they pray for a musician, but I chose you. I want to make sure you understand that when they prayed, I could have chose anybody else I wanted to choose. But I looked down and I chose you. I chose you. So don't you get high-minded when people say they pray for you. Don't you get high-minded when I put you in a position, because anything that I do it. He's, anything that he does is his will, not my will. This is why we work. This is why we sacrifice. Okay? Because for six and a half years, I was on the outside looking in. And the Lord brought us into the truth. There are souls, okay, who are fighting, who are studying, who are in Trinitarian churches, okay, who are under women pastors, okay, who are in Catholicism, okay, who are in Methodists, Muslims, okay, Buddhists, okay, who are looking for the truth. The Bible says that, and I believe it's in Matthew, I'm going to put the scripture, but the Bible says, he who hungers and thirsts after righteousness shall be filled. Shall be filled. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Y'all pray my strength in the Lord.
Amen.